Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Stephen Bernstein, you're here as artist in residence at Jazz Baltic, and as such, you've performed with the Jazz Baltic Ensemble, but that was something totally different to what you've done with Sex Mob. Now, tell me, how did Sex Mob come into being? What were your thoughts when you started this band?
Well, Sex Mob is interesting because Sex Mob started only as a vehicle to use a slide trumpet. Up to then, I'd been playing the slide trumpet, you know, just a little bit, maybe one or two songs, on a, maybe with a few groups. I started to think about it. I said, what if I wonder what this instrument can do, because no one's ever really played it. I mean, people have played it. I don't want to make it seem like no one played it, but no one really, like, really took advantage of it in, like, in depth. So I said, what if I put together a band, and all I do is bring the slide trumpet? So I had met Brigham, the saxophone player, in Seattle about 6 months before, and I knew he was moving to New York, and I really liked him and his playing, so I called him, and Kenny I've known since he was a kid in California, and Kenny had just moved to New York, and our regular bass player, who's not here, he's actually the one who made me brave enough to do it, because he was a guy who was playing a lot of, like, straight. I said, well, yeah, well, I try only playing. He said, well, you have it together now. I said, well, if I call you, would you come play with me? He said, yeah, give me a call. Here's my phone number. So that's how it started.
One of the interesting words that's used a lot about bands like Sex Mob, of course, is deconstruction, about taking things that are perhaps well-known, taking them apart, putting them back together again. It also applies to your other project, the Millennial Territory Orchestra.
Right.
Maybe you could tell me a bit about the approach to doing that kind of work.
Yeah, but they use the term deconstruction, but to me it's not. I mean, I understand what that term means, but the idea is every artist, it's their job, every jazz musician, let me say, I mean, we were talking about being, am I a jazz musician or not? Here's the thing. I think it's every jazz musician's job to recreate their music, create the music in their own image. So this is just kind of how I look at the world. So if it fits into the umbrella of deconstructionism, that's fine. But it's really just my personal philosophy, which is having grown up loving jazz and being like a jazz trumpet player as a young kid, then, like, you know, kind of realizing that the music that really is like my music that I grew up with is more, well, the Beatles and Sly and the Family Stone and Parliament Funkadelic, and kind of realizing it's okay to love this music that just is inside of me because I grew up with it. And then at a pretty early age, about 15 or 16, I just became like a Duke Ellington. Duke Ellington became my religion. I became like, you know how some people become Hare Krishnas? I became like a Duke Ellington convert at about 16. And I usually listened to Duke Ellington every day of my life from about 18 to 40. I probably listened to Duke Ellington every single day without missing a day. Like religion. Like, you just, that's what you do. You listen to Duke Ellington. And so when And combining all these things about and having a kind of psychedelic approach to life, purposefully psychedelic, like in, like realizing that, you know, we used to talk about the doors of perception, opening the doors of perception, and the idea is that you want to try to open those doors when you play music too. You want to try to make the unknown, like approach the unknown, and I tend to approach it in a funny way because I enjoy humor. So some people like the fear of the unknown. I think the unknown's kind of funny. You know, but that's how I look at life. So that's how I came up to this, what people call deconstructionism, but it's just my construction, as opposed to deconstruction, it's my construction.
How would you approach, let's say, a song by Sly Stone or Parliament Funkadelic?
It matters who I'm writing for. Like, because like I said, I come from Duke Ellington. So in a sense, I think about who my musicians are and what the potential is of their instruments and of them, their personalities. And I try to always let the personalities come through, you know. And, you know, I'm glad this worked today because these bass lines weren't written for Martin. They were written for Tony, my bass player. But Martin did a great job of, like, kind of capturing, you know, letting himself come through but kind of taking Tony's role. But all this music is like, you know, like that beat, that at one point Kenny came in and that one beat near the end and everyone started moving. I mean, that's that thing. I said, only Kenny Wollison can do that. That's why I said that, because that's one of those things. I mean, yeah, everyone wants to play this and wants to play that, but there are certain things that only we can do as an individual. And sometimes it might not be what you want to do. You know, someone once told me that when you listen to something you do and something makes you uncomfortable, that's actually what you sound like. Everything else that you like refers to something else that you heard before. And that's why you like it, because it reminds you of something that you like. And the stuff that's a little unknown can make you uncomfortable, but that's actually what you do.
I've spoken to several people at this year's festival who are all pretty much about your age, of your generation. Joe Locke, for instance, or Dave Douglas, and they've all kind of said there's a feeling at the moment it's like a changing of the guard as far as jazz is concerned. A lot of the great jazz musicians are no longer with us. There's a lot of jazz musicians now who are about 40 or a little bit above 40 who are doing very different things. And in that sense, I was going to ask you, integrating electronics as you do with Sex Mob, for instance, with DJ Olive, how does that work for you? Whether you're a jazz musician or not, we won't talk about right. that, but how do you integrate that into a jazz format?
Well, DJ Olive is not a regular member of Sex Mob. He has performed with us on occasion, and he's a friend of ours. I treat him, like I said, like an improviser. Remember when I introduced him, I said one of my favorite improvisers. To me, it's all, I don't really differentiate. A musician's a musician to me. So I listen to DJ Olive and I try to let him be himself within the context of what I do. I try to give him room to be DJ Olive, but not, you know, make my music not, I don't want my music to sound like his music. I want to use what he does to enhance my music. That's the same thing I do with everybody. I try to, like, basically use what they do to make me sound better.
We'll leave it there, I think. That's a good point to stop.
Yeah, Steven, thanks so much.
Thank
All
you
right.
very much. Thank you. Thank you.
song is dedicated to my hometown, Oakland, California. We'll be right back.
Yes, I got that. Yeah, sure. And this is not necessarily just keep rolling, but that's all you need to answer. But what you're saying is that let's get back one more time. Let me throw one more thing at you that we've already discussed already, but I'm just going to do it again.
Thank you.
Sixth Mob, thank you.